I'd like to thank the organizers of this session for allowing us to present our recent work on insights into the cell origin of the histiocytoses using patient-derived xenograft models. So one of the burning questions currently is, what cells actually give rise to histiocytoses? And about 40 years ago, LCH was found to arise from Langerhans cells, and this was for two reasons. That Langerhans cells and LCH cells both shared antigenic markers and had Birkbeck granules and white-tar microscopy. And this was believed for about 40 years. And finally, some work that came out of the Texas Children's Group with Kim McLean and Carl Allen found that LCH cells actually have transcriptional profiles more similar to monocyte-derived precursors rather than Langerhans cells. And then many groups that work on the ontogeny of macrophages and dendritic cells in mouse models found that epidermal Langerhans cells actually arise from fetal liver monocytes rather than bone marrow-derived hematopoietic precursors in the murine system. And then after the discovery of BRAF-V600E in both Langerhans cell histiocytosis and then in Irvine-Chester disease, the same group from the University of Texas and Texas Children's Hospital with Kim McLean and Carl Allen, as well as Miriam Rod from Mount Sinai, found that BRAF-V600E was detected in the bone marrow precursors of high-risk BRAF-V600E mutated LCH patients. And as you can see from this timeline, that most of the work in the area of histiocytoses and their cell origin has occurred in Langerhans cell histiocytoses. And now, in recent years, we're now moving into the non-Langerhans cell histiocytic neoplasms, such as Irvine-Chester disease. And work that came from collaboration with our colleagues here in Paris, as well as our work at Memorial Sloan Kettering Cancer Center and with MD Anderson Cancer Center in our recent cancer discovery paper published late last year, found that LCH and non-LCH neoplastic cells actually have distinct transcriptional profiles. So raises the question, they may have distinct cells of origin. And so we started looking into these cells of origin. And before we move into our work on the mouse modeling, there's also been a lot of work in the groups that actually work on the ontogeny of macrophages in the mouse system. So they originally found that mesoderm actually gives rise to intra-embryonic hemogenic endothelium, which gives rise to epidermal Langerhans cells, and also hematopoietic stem cells, which have self-renewal capacity. These also give rise to monocyte dendritic cell precursors and can lead to tissue-resident macrophages, which involve the Kupffer cells of the liver, the microglia of the central nervous system, and the Langerhans cells of the epidermis. And then recent work that came out of the Frederick Geisman lab has actually found another pathway in mouse that actually can lead to fetal tissue-resident macrophages through the yolk sac-derived hemogenic endothelium that can also arise from the mesoderm. It can give rise to yolk sac-derived erythromyeloid progenitors. And this can give rise to fetal liver macrophages and monocytes, which can also give rise to tissue-resident macrophages independent of the hematopoietic stem cells. So it leaves many options for cells of origin that we may find in the mouse system and mouse models as we start working in this area for the systemic histiocytic neoplasms. So kind of a summary of what we've found so far in the history of the ontogeny and the cell origin of Langerhans cell histiocytic neoplasms as well as Irvine-Chester disease is that Barris et al. Suggested LCH is a clonal disorder arising from hematopoietic stem or progenitor cells that acquire somatic mutations in the oncogenic pathway leading to histiocytoses. However, this raises several questions because they did not find BRAF-V600 mutations in this V34 positive compartment of all BRAF-V600E mutated LCH patients. Also, expression of the BRAF-V600E in a CD11C Cre BRAF-V600E mouse model also described in the 2014 paper did not recapitulate all phenotypic consequences of human Langerhans cell histiocytosis, which opened the possibility of alternate cells of origin of the systemic histiocytosis, such as potentially tissue-resident macrophages that arise from the erythroid myeloid progenitors. But a key component that we focused on is that comparable studies have never been published in Irvine-Chester disease and other non-LCH neoplasms, and whether or not the hematopoietic stem and progenitor cells from histiocytosis patients actually have functional self-renewal potential has not been described. So we asked the following two questions. Can hematopoietic stem and progenitor cells from systemic histiocytosis patients functionally give rise to these disorders? And can we generate patient-derived xenograft models of histiocytic neoplasms for further functional analysis or in vivo treatment? So, with our collaboration with the research group here at INSER Research Center in Paris, including Julia Faroche, Jean-François Neu, Matthias Pappo and others, we've actually collected, we've seen an uncanny overlap, which Matthias will talk about later, between other myeloid neoplasms and histiocytic neoplasms. And so we actually agreed to use 8 samples from patients that actually have histiocytic neoplasms and a few that actually have other overlapping myeloid neoplasms that actually have been characterized mutationally, so we actually know drivers we can follow in xenograft models as we transplant these humans' CD34 positive cells into NSGS mice, which I'll describe. And so I'll be talking about our work in using these 8 samples. So we actually harvested bone marrow from these patients, and we enriched for CD34 positive hematopoietic stem cells using immunomagnetic selection. We transplanted these CD34 positive hematopoietic stem cells into sublethally irradiated NSGS mice, which are mice that can actually support the transplant of human myeloid cells fairly well, using TIL-vein injection. And we monitored these mice using peripheral blood for engraftment, and then once the mice became very sick and moribund, we had to sacrifice the mice. So the first mouse that actually became moribund was a xenograft model we created from patient 7, which is an Erdem-Chester disease patient was driven by KRAS G12S. And the patient also had heart involvement with Erdem-Chester disease. As we can see, there's massive infiltration of the cardiac myocytes by foaming histiocytes that are strongly CD68 positive within the patient's heart biopsy. And this actual xenograft model, as we followed the mouse over 3 months before it got sick, we saw a progressive pancytopenia developing. So we can see by a progressive anemia, a progressive decrease in white blood cells, and a worsening macrocytic anemia, as you can see by the increasing MCV. And we also did, as I mentioned, we did flow cytometry analysis to monitor engraftment in the peripheral blood initially before sacrificing the mice. And on the y-axis, we have human CD45 by flow, and mouse CD45, which will be on mouse populations of hematopoietic cells, and this will be on human populations of hematopoietic cells. They showed we saw an engraftment of human CD45 positive cells that was progressive, but yet very modest in the peripheral blood, but the mouse did become sick nonetheless, so we had to sacrifice the mouse. And we saw higher percentages of human CD45 positive cells in the bone marrow, spleen, liver, lung, and kidney. And looking specifically at the cells that were human CD45 positive, we also saw that a large proportion of these cells also express the human monocyte-specific marker human CD14. So, and also by looking at using histology and immunohistochemistry, we looked at the hematopoietic tissues, the bone marrow, and the spleen from this patient-derived xenograft model, and saw its infiltration of large mononuclear cells with pink foamy cytoplasm that were human CD45 positive. We also found that these infiltrating cells were actually positive for human CD68 and negative for human CD1A. So these were foamy histiocytes of the human origin actually infiltrating the hematopoietic tissues of this mouse. Also, we saw that the monocyte macrophage-specific marker human CD163 was also present on many of these cells in the bone marrow and spleen. So in addition to hematopoietic tissues, we looked at other tissues and saw infiltration of the liver and lung by human CD45 positive and human CD163 positive foamy histiocytes in this, involving these tissues as well. Then when we extracted DNA from the bone marrow and spleen of the patient-derived xenograft model that we generated from ECD patient number 7, we found the same KRAS G12S mutation in the bone marrow and spleen that was driving the patient's Erdem-Chester disease. So in addition to this, we've also had some other engraftments in xenografts derived from patient 3 as well as patient 8. Patient 8 actually has ECD that's driven by BRAF V600B and no other myeloid neoplasm, and patient 3 actually has ECD and myeloproliferative neoplasm overlap. And these xenograft models are still alive, but they are showing a reasonable engraftment, although still modest, in the bone marrow aspirate that we did on these mice. And these are actually showing populations that are positive for human CD16, which is on myeloid cells, and that also shows double positive for human CD14 and human CD16. So there's actually a monocyte component and a myeloid component engrafting in these mice, but they're still alive. We're still monitoring them. We wait for further engraftment, and we'll be analyzing those further. And once they become moribund, we'll do a very detailed evaluation as we did for the patient 7 xenograft model. So basically in our preliminary work, we have conclusions that the functional evidence of the CD34 positive compartment can actually initiate histiocytosis. But several things, as current studies involve adult histiocytic disorders only, but pediatric histiocytosis may have different cells of origin. We have to do further work to determine the frequency of successful engraftment of CD34 positive cells in histiocytosis. But based on our current experience, there's at least engraftment of 1 out of 8. And we're doing this by further evaluating our PDX models. And we also did serial transplantation of patient 7 xenograft into other NSGS mice using purified human CD34 positive cells from that xenograft that we had sacrificed. We've also actually started transplanting NSGS mice that with normal human CD34 positive cord blood, so that we could have a positive control of what actually happens with normal human hematopoietic stem cells in an NSGS mouse population. But a key component we and others are going to have to address in the near future is the interrogation of different purified cell subsets from the systemic histiocytosis patients, so we can actually refine our understanding of the cells of origin of the systemic histiocytosis, which I think Matt Paul may be talking about later. Now, I'd like to thank my research mentor, Omar Abdullah, for his guidance throughout this project, as well as our clinical colleagues, Eli Diamond from the World Sloan Kettering Cancer Center, and our clinical colleagues joining our research unit in Paris, France, including Julien Laroche, Jean-François Amir, Mathias Papel, Jean Donahue, and of course our funding sources, including the Chester Disease Global Alliance. I'll take any questions if there's time.
Thank you, Ben. It's a great, great result and a great talk. You have any questions? I think as the next subject is different, we can have a question at this moment.
You probably know the answer to this, but what does JAK2 mutated CD34 look like by itself?
JAK2 mutated CD34?
When you put it in the mice.
We haven't actually had an engraftment of JAK2 that we know of yet, so.
So just the standard
NPN is working. Yeah. These mice that maybe have JAK2, we may find that, but we're still monitoring these mice, and we don't know what exactly. They're not showing any mutation yet, so. But they are showing a small population. So as we continue to monitor these mice, we will find out when we have to evaluate their tissues fully, like when they become sick.
Actually, I had a brief conversation about it this morning before we just started, but I mean, when I actually genotype some of my patients, I noticed also in two of them recently the mutation in ASXL1, and that's essentially what you showed in some of these with the myeloproliferative neoplasms, which kind of makes me feel that it's probably not a coincidence. So I just wonder whether actually we should do the bone marrow in these patients to find out if there's some if there's some myeloproliferative disease.
Yeah, I'm sure.
In addition to which maybe might be benign enough not to really manifest itself to differentiate from UCD. But I mean, it's a kind of fairly striking that, I mean, you showed 8 patients, 2 of them have ASXL1. I mean, I genotype, I don't know how many 5 patients over the last year and came with 2 ASXL1.
Well, I know Matthias is going to be addressing this in his study of 189 patients that have shown overlap between our 2 centers later in this talk. But I mean, I can mention that I would think doing a bone marrow would be very reasonable as a pathologist in these patients, because we actually had a conversation about this at the European Association for Hematopathology meeting in Switzerland where I was last week. And when we talked about a case actually had overlap, several different cases in the workshop were actually overlap of some of the myeloid neoplasms and histiocytic neoplasms, since their focus was on histiocytic neoplasms. And they think that, yeah, maybe if there's, in the correct clinical setting, a bone marrow should be done on any patient, of course, that with histiocytosis to see if there is an underlying myeloid malignancy. But maybe Matthias can address that further in his study later on, because he's going to be talking about that.
So I might be too early jumping on that. So what do we feel would be prevalence? Would be prevalence of this myeloid neoplasms overall in the UC? Is it something which you can guess or not yet? Because then maybe we can actually revise the guidelines to actually include a bone marrow on everybody.
Yeah, that would be Matthias has a nice big study on that he'll be talking about in a few talks after that, so he can address that.
All right. We have another talk on the subject, I think.
Yeah.
Any other questions? I'm not aware of such overlap syndrome with LCH. Have you seen such cases? Not at the moment. No. So this is a difference with ECD.
Yeah, there are still differences. We have ECD. Of course, I'm sure there's a few. Occasionally, we see some that have ECD-LCH overlap, I think, as well as some that very few, maybe 1 or 2, in adult LCH that may have this as well. But I'm sure the study that Matthias will tell us about will shed some light on this for us all in a few minutes, I suppose. Any other questions?